Welcome everybody to this week's Oxford Discrete Maths and Probability Seminar. So just before we get started, a few things to say. We'd like to encourage you to ask questions in the first instance in the chat box if you can. It's useful if you do this under your own name so that people know who's talking. Alex and I will make some determination about whether the questions need to be asked of the speaker for clarification in the moment or whether they can be left till the end. And if they need to be taken in the moment, we'll interrupt. We will be recording this seminar. If you do not wish to be recorded, please make sure to keep your video off and your sound muted. I have force muted everybody at the moment, but at the end I will unmute people one by one if they want to ask questions. So this is the very first of our kind of special thematic days. So today we're focusing on random glass and random planar maps. And it's a huge pleasure to have Grégory Mirmont with us from Ernest Lyon. And he's going to be speaking about the breadth first construction of the scaling limit of random graphs with finite excess.
Okay, thank you very much. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So, well, first of all, thanks a lot to Christina and Alex for inviting me. It's really a great pleasure. I must say I'm a bit stressed too, because it's I've been teaching a couple of classes online like this, but not a research seminar. So it's a bit of a first time for me. And it's also the first time I'm using this device with a tablet. So I hope this is going to run smoothly. So I'm going to talk about a recent joint work with Sanjay and Sen at Bangalore, and it's about a new construction, let's say, of scaling limits of objects which you can view as random graphs and certain models of random maps in the scaling limit. Okay, so let me start by giving a little bit of motivation. So the goal is going to be the study of let's say quite elementary models of graphs in terms of complexity. So to study models of large random graphs. So by large, I mean, let's say, a large number of vertices. And I want all those graphs to be connected. And I'm going to measure the complexity, let's say, with going to have a fixed complexity. And I'm going to measure this complexity by the number E of G, which is going to be the number of edges minus the number of vertices plus one. Okay. And this notion of complexity, so this plus one is really the number of connected components of G. But since we assumed in the first place that G is a connected graph, this is just one. And this complexity is usually called the excess of the graph or the surplus of the graph, depending on the texts which refer to this quantity. And so in what sense does it measure the complexity of a graph? Well, if E of G is equal to zero, then this exactly means that G is a tree. Okay, so something like this. And E of G equals one means that G is what is called sometimes a unicycle. And a unicycle is just a graph made of one cycle on top of which you get some, let's say, subtrees that are pending. So if you prefer, the excess is really the number of edges that you need to remove from your graph to obtain a tree. Okay. Now, what can be said about scaling limits of such objects? Well, there is a very well-known case, which I'm going to discuss a little bit, which is the case of zero excess. And in this case, I'm going to call Gn. So it's going to be a uniform random tree over the vertex set, which is going to be the first n integers. And okay, let me copy this. Okay, so let's consider this elementary case somehow. The Gn is going to be a uniform random tree over the vertex set. Maybe I'm going to recall that it has excess zero by putting a little exponent zero here. And then it is very well known that as n goes to infinity, this Gn naught sort of approximates a limiting shape. So in what sense can you consider this? You can consider this graph where I want to rescale all the edge lengths by a common factor square root n. So this is really the metric space in which all edges get the same length, 1 over square root n. And as a metric space, it is known that this random object converges as n goes to infinity in distribution to a limiting metric space, which I'm going to call 2t of e. And this is called the continuum random tree. Which was introduced by Aldous in the 90s. Okay, so I'm not going to fully review the construction of this scaling limit, and I'm not going to be too precise about what it means to have this convergence in distribution. But what you should imagine is that as n goes bigger and bigger, this Gn with this rescale distance approximate an object which is still random, but now which is really a continuous metric tree. So why is this limit called 2 times t of e? Well, it simply, okay, it comes from the fact that this, let's say, the most convenient and quickest definition for this object can be stated in terms of what is called the standard Brownian excursion. And the standard Brownian excursion is just a random function defined on the interval 0, 1, which somehow looks like Brownian motion, except that it's conditioned to remain positive and to be equal to 0 at times 0 and 1. Okay, so if you prefer, it's Brownian motion with this conditioning, except that, of course, this conditioning is by a zero probability event, so you need to be a little more careful to define properly this this object. And then it is well known how to define a tree structure out of such a random excursion. And the idea is that you can define, in fact, a metric by saying that two points S and T are going to be a distance dE of ST, which is equal to the length let me use maybe another color. The length of the segment that connects the point with altitude E of S to the minimum of the excursion between times S and T, and then back to E of T. So formally, the definition is that the distance between S and T is going to be E of S plus E of T minus twice the minimum of E in the time interval between S and T. Okay. And so this definition, it defines a distance function on the interval 0, 1, except that it's going to identify certain points, namely, those will be the points that are facing each other under the graph of E. So you really have to take the quotient of the interval 0, 1. So you really have to define T of E to be 0, 1, quotiented by all points which are at distance 0 apart. And now this defines a properly defined metric space, which is called the continuum random tree. Okay, so if you didn't get all the details of this construction, it's not so important for this talk, because I'm not going to use too much this construction, but I think at least it's good to it gives you a feel of what's going on here. And the 2 here just means that I'm multiplying all the distances by 2. Okay, or if you prefer, you could also say that it's the tree coded by twice the Brownian excursion instead of once. And this factor 2 here is really a renormalization factor, which comes from the model I've been considering. Okay, so somehow this is very classical. It's a fundamental result about random trees, and it also applies to many other models of random trees, and not only the uniform label tree on n vertices. Now, more generally, it's understood what happens when you consider Gn of S, okay, let me write that a little more properly, which is going to be a uniform random graph on vertices 1, 2 up to the n with fixed excess E Gn of S is equal to S for some integer S, which is a fixed once and for all. And it's also understood what the scaling limit of this object looks like. So maybe let me draw a little reference picture. So you should imagine that maybe now this object has a certain number of cycles, but does not have infinitely many cycles, okay? Because again, S is fixed, and it does not depend on n. So maybe you should picture a graph, a large graph G and S like this, okay? And in fact, it is an important step in a paper by Adario Berri, Broutin, and Goldschmidt. They study the scaling limits of GNS. So I should say that in their paper, the surplus is really a random variable, but it's a tight random variable. So from the result, you immediately get the result by conditioning on the value of the surplus. And why were they interested in these objects? Well, it's in their study of the scaling limits of the Erdős-Reni random graphs in the critical regime, or let's say in the critical, what's called sometimes the critical window. Okay, and somehow the scaling limits serve as building blocks for somehow the Erdős-Reni random graph in the scaling window is not just one connected component. There are many connected components, but the claim is that each of these connected components is a graph with a finite excess. Okay, and the scaling limit can be described in the way that I'm going to state now. So let me state the theorem by the 3 people I just mentioned. So again, if you take Gn of S and rescale distances by square root of n, then this converges in distribution as n goes to infinity to a limit I'm going to call H of S, which is the, let's say, the continuum random graph of excess fixed, of excess S. And what I'm going to do now is to describe the limit for you. And of course, the limit is also described in terms of a Brownian excursion, if you like. Except that now this Brownian excursion is going to come with a certain number of decorations that will have the effect of tilting the law of the excursion. So let me describe it now. So let E of S have a law which is defined in terms of the Brownian excursion by a change of measure. So if I want to consider the expectation of some functional of the excursion S, then I can write it in terms of the expectation of the same functional for E, except that I'm going to twist this functional by the total area under the Brownian excursion, so the integral from 0 to 1 of the excursion to the power S. And of course, this is not a probability distribution if I define it in this way, because if I take F to be just equal to 1 everywhere, then I will get on the right-hand side, I actually even have a laser pointer here, I will get on the right-hand side the expectation of the area under the Brownian excursion to the S, which is not 1. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to rescale by a constant factor, which is just the expectation of this quantity. Okay. Okay, so that's the first step. So if you like this E of S, it has all the, you know, it shares the same almost sure events as a Brownian excursion, except that it will tend maybe to give a little more weight to excursions which have a large area because of this change of measure. Okay. And now what I'm going to do, let me maybe draw a little picture for this excursion. What I'm going to do is I'm going to sample points, let's say T1, H1, T2, H2, T3, H3. And as I mentioned here, T1, T2, T3 are going to be points in the interval 0, 1. And H1, H2, H3 are going to be points that stand somewhere between 0 and the altitude of each time. So I should say maybe I'm taking T1, H1 up to TS, HS with probability distribution function, which is going to be uniform in the T marginal, so T1 up to TS, and it's going to be proportional to the height at times T1 E of TS of HS, DH1 up to DHS. Okay, and I should say that it's proportional again to this quantity, so there is a constant C that of course depends on the actually on the area of the of the probability distribution function. So let me again take these two things and explain what it means in terms of the tree. Okay, so this is starting to be a little bit messy. Sorry about that. I guess this is a ZS here. Okay. And this is the bar of the expectation that should come over here. Okay. So what did I actually do with this device in terms of the tree? What I've been doing is, if you look at the continuum tree that appeared before, except that I'm now going to take the tree coded not by the excursion, but by this tilted excursion, I've been choosing a certain number of points which turn out to be the leaves, to be leaves of this tree, let's say T1, T2, T3, and a certain number of ancestors whose height correspond to the ordinate of these H1, H2, H3 that appeared on the picture of the Brownian excursion. And the final construction, the final step in the construction of HS is to define HS to be the quotient, to be the tree encoded by the excursion E of S, except that I want to identify together the pair of points that have been selected by step two. Okay, so I'm going to take a quotient of this tree by the equivalence relation where I'm going to let Ti be equivalent to Ti prime, where Ti prime is, Ti prime is really the point, maybe I should have been more precise here. Okay, so this is really T1 prime, T2 prime, and T3 prime. And what corresponds to H is really the height of these points. So this is H2 and this is H3. So formally, what does it correspond to? So in terms of the tree, you can imagine this T1 prime to be the first time where the excursion is back to level H1 after T1. Okay, so Ti prime it's not very important here. It's more important that you get a feeling of what happens on the picture of the tree. Ti prime is the first T after Ti where the excursion has height H of I. Okay, so again, if you didn't get all the details of this construction, because it involves actually quite a lot of processes, what you should just remember is that the resulting space H of S is really a tree in which you have identified S pairs of points together. So in doing so, for every identified pair of points, you have created a new cycle in the tree. Okay, so it's quite obvious in a sense that this object is really an object with surplus or with excess equal to S. Okay, you've just added S circles from the S cycles from a tree. Okay. All right. Now, one of the issues somehow with this construction. So I want to make two comments about this construction. First of all, it tends to distort quite a bit the distances in the tree. For instance, if you look at the distance from the base point of the tree, so the green point which corresponds to the point zero on the Brownian excursion, you can see that the distance from this root rho to the point with height T3, it has been transformed from the height E of T3, the value of the excursion at time T3, into the height of T prime 3, because these two points now are identified in the tree. So it really distorts the distances from the root in a way that is maybe not so easy to understand, especially since you are doing many of these identifications. And so each of these identifications is susceptible to distort the distances in the tree in a certain way. Okay, so somehow one issue is that it changes distances from the root. And so what did I want to say? Maybe at this point it's the main issue that I have. And maybe if I'm back to the picture of GNS, or if you like, you could imagine that this is a finite version of this scaling limit H of S. It is also natural that you should be able to somehow unfold this object in another tree in a way that you do not modify the distances to the root row. Okay, so row maybe for me is going to be the vertex with label 1. So how so? Well, you could imagine, and this is something actually which is appearing quite a lot in the theory of random maps, you could imagine that you let a little bit of water flow at unit speed from the root row. Okay, so it's going to slowly invade your tree. And it's going to, okay, let's imagine maybe that at time, maybe at time t equals 3, I've got the ball centered at row of radius 3, which is represented in orange here. And as time continues, you are going to continue invading your tree up to the moment where several of your geodesics are going to meet at the same point here. And at this point, you just want to disconnect. Maybe let me use another color. You maybe want to disconnect these geodesics together, I should say, from one another. And you are going to continue like this in all of the tree. And again, here, in this part, you want to disconnect, and here you want to disconnect. So when you completely invade the tree, you see that you, okay, maybe actually this is a good thing. You see that you've also somehow turned your graph into a tree in such a way that all the distances from row are preserved. And this tree, okay, again, what's important in this description is that, let's say, the point that you approach on this side is different from the point that you approach on this other side here. I want to call this tree the breadth first tree. I want to call that the breadth first tree. Of GNS. Okay. And you see that somehow the construction that I gave here, or that Luigi, Nicola, and Cristina gave here, does not give the breadth first tree of the resulting graph. Again, because it distorts the distances from the root. Okay? So it's kind of natural to try to understand how you can define properly this object. And another comment is that, okay, so maybe the first comment was that it changes distance radius from the root. So can one understand the breadth first tree of GNS and its scaling limit H of S? And the second is maybe slightly less well-motivated, but this construction was, in fact, the definition for the scaling limit that I just gave was inspired by a paper by Aldous, who was also working on the scaling limit of the Erdős-Reinier random graph in the critical regime. But he was not really interested in the shapes of the components of the random graph. He was more interested in the the sizes of these components. And he actually used a breadth first description of these components instead of the depth first description which you can find in the paper by Luigi, Nicola, and Cristina. Okay, and in fact, it is a question in Luigi, Nicola, and Cristina's paper whether you can also define you know, the scaling limit, the space H of S, in terms of the breadth first construction of Aldous, it's less obvious because it tends to explore large chunks of the tree at the same time. So it seems that you might lose something when you do this construction. But what we do with Sunshine is we show that it's actually possible to give this alternative construction. Okay. So with Sunshine, we provide such an alternative construction. Okay, so this sort of ends the paragraph on motivation. And now I'm going to describe for you, you know, okay, so maybe I have questions here.
I think we've dealt with everything that's come up.
Okay. Okay, excellent. So please don't hesitate to interrupt me. So what I would like to do is to quickly give an idea of the discrete construction, and then I'm going to give the continuum construction. Okay, so one thing about this construction is that, which actually connects maybe a little more to the topic of today's seminar, is that by contrast with the above, we actually use an approximation by random maps. That is, these are not really graphs, you know, with n labeled vertices. They are really embedded graphs. Embedded graphs in the plane. And in particular, so we provide, we show in passing that the scaling limit of a uniform map with excess n and n plus one vertices, that's of course s, with fixed excess s and n plus one vertices is h of s as well. Okay, and this is of course not at all surprising, and there are many papers by Sunshine, Shankar Bamidi, Luigi Adario Berri, Nicolas Boutin, and many others who are interested in the universal aspect of this scaling limit. And in fact, of course, much more is known. But for most of these models, in most of these papers, they focus more on models like configuration models, which are more closely related maybe to problems around Herder-Schwenny random graphs, and not really about planar maps. Okay, so that's maybe a slightly different point of view. And in passing, we also construct, let's say recover the scaling limit of what are called unicellular random maps of genus G. And those maps are, you know, maps with only one face, and this forces the surplus S to be equal to two times G, okay, where G is the genus of the surface on which the map stands. So I'm not going to focus on this on this model, but it's also a well-known model which is considered in particular in a paper by Chapuis, although it's maybe a bit implicit. And in another paper by Luigi Adarioberi, Omer Angel, Chapuis, I hope I'm not going to forget anyone, Fusi and Christina Goldschmidt, which considers the a problem of Voronoi cells on random maps. And the scaling limit of unicellular random maps of genus G is one of the models for which they can, for which the results hold. Okay. But again, the construction that they give is different from the one that we propose, and it's also based. Essentially, it's a conditioned version of this scaling limit result. If you like. A unicellular map also has a fixed excess, and you also have to condition on certain extra properties which happen with positive probability for a uniform map with fixed excess. Okay. So I'm not going to focus on that anymore. Okay, so let me focus a little bit on the discrete construction. And let's maybe start from a map. Okay, so in this case, I'm going to consider a map with a excess, which is only going to be equal to 2. So as I was saying, an object really looks like a tree. So let me actually use the one that I done in my notes. And okay, so what you should imagine is that this graph is really lying on a certain surface, which is, in general, it does not have to be the plane. And in particular, in this situation, I have something that looks like a crossing of edges, but it's really not the case. It's really standing, if you like, on a surface that allows these edges not to cross. Maybe I'm going to finish like this. And you see that the resulting graph can be turned into a tree by disconnecting two cycles, this little self loop here, and let's say this edge there. And what you are going to do is to start from a root corner. And this root corner is going to be in the first step to be the only active corner. And we are going to assume that the rest is somehow an unexplored region in the map. And now I'm going to perform an exploration in the map that is going to turn this map back into a tree plus certain identifications. So, So what should I do? So let's start, step one. We start from root is the only active. So actually going to need the notion of a corner here. So a corner in a map is just going to be a small angular section around a vertex. Okay, so for instance, this vertex here has 3 incident corners, okay? And these corners are arranged in cyclic order around every vertex, okay? Okay, so at step one, the root is the only active corner, and the tree that I want to build is just restricted to the root. Okay. And now at every step, so step I go to step I plus one, we move to the next corner just after the active corner. Okay. So in this situation, what do I mean by just after? So I mean the corner that you encounter when you go around the map in, let's say, clockwise order. Okay, you look at the corners one after the other in the clockwise order of the underlying surface. So in this situation, for instance, at step one, I'm going to look at this corner and I'm going to call this, so unactivate the previous active corner and activate the new corner. Okay, so here at step one, this is going to be unactivated and this one is going to be the new active corner.
Doug, may I just check that in the case that the root does not have degree one, you just pick one of its corners to start
from? Yeah, absolutely. So again, so I've been a little bit loose on that, but the root, you should imagine the root to be in fact a corner. It is a corner, and that's why I said that T at step one is the root vertex. Okay, so I really want the tree to start with this vertex, and so far I've only explored one of the corners incident to this vertex. Yeah, so sorry if it was not very clear. Okay. Now what do I do? So if the new corner is so what should I say here? Okay, so of course, okay, in going from one corner to the next one, I have to go along an edge, okay? So if the explored edge going to this new corner does not create a cycle in T, we add it to T. Okay. So here I should be a little bit careful here because there are really two situations. So let me maybe explain what happens on this particular example. So here at step one, I'm just adding this new edge to T. Okay, and after step one, T is going to be made only of this edge. Okay. Then what happens at step two? I'm going to move from the previously active corner to the next available corner. And then what happens? Well, again, in doing so, I'm exploring an edge which does not create a cycle in T. So at the end of step two, T is going to be this tree and the active corner is going to be this corner. Okay, similarly for step three, okay, at step three, I'm just adding one edge and the active corner is going to be, oh, sorry about that. And the active corner is going to be the corner around this vertex. Now something interesting happens because after this corner, the next available corner is a corner incident to a vertex that I already explored. But of course, it's now a new corner around this vertex. And in going from that corner, I'm going along an edge which I've already explored. And from the fact that I already explored this edge, of course, it's not going to create a cycle in T. Okay, so I just keep it in T. I just don't have to add it. Okay, I've already added it to T. So at the end of step, I guess, 1, 2, 3, 4, the active corner is this guy and the tree T hasn't changed. Okay, I just moved to another corner. Okay, now at step 5, I have to move to this corner and add this new edge to T. And now something interesting happens again, because in step 6, I'm going to explore, you know, the next available corner around this edge. And this brings me, you know, to the other side of this tree. Again, you should remember that there are no edge crossings here. So I really have to follow to this next corner. And adding this edge here would create a cycle in the tree. So what I'm going to do is to just forget about this edge. So I'm just going to remove it. Okay. So maybe let me leave it in this way, but I'm otherwise remove this edge and continue exploring after the active corner. Okay, so in this case, I'm not going to move the active corner to the other side of the edge. I'm just going somehow to, I'm just going somehow to forget about this edge and then in this case, the active corner is going to remain this guy. Okay. Mm-hmm. And therefore, at the next step, I'm going to explore this edge, move to this active corner here, and continue in this way. Okay, so I'm going to be back in the tree. And then after a certain number of steps, which I've lost the count for, I'm going to again create a new cycle in the tree T. So I shouldn't add this, edge. So I just discard it and finish the exploration. So I'm exploring this edge. Then I must be back in the tree to that edge which hadn't been explored before. I add it to the tree, then back to that edge which I'm adding, and then I'm finished. Okay. Okay. So this construction is actually not a breadth-first construction. It's really a depth-first construction that is really in the spirit of Luigi, Nicola, and Cristina's paper. So this is really a depth-first. Construction. And at the end, you end with a tree, T, plus a collection of S pairs of corners. Okay. So in the picture that stands here, so maybe I will now remove the cycles, but recall that I had to connect this corner to that corner and to connect this corner to that corner. Okay, and maybe let me call these corners I1, J1, and then I2, J2. Okay. So let's maybe call them IK, JK. And the property, which really comes from the construction, is that JK is a corner that is, let's say, incident to an ancestor of the vertex incident to IK. So maybe if I1 is here, this is V of I1. If I2 is here, maybe this is V of I2. So that's really the vertex incident to this corner. So J has to be an ancestor of I, and it also comes after in the depth first exploration. Okay, so again, it just comes from the construction. Just comes from the construction that let's say, for instance, this J has to come after I in the exploration of the tree. Okay, it really comes from the construction. And similarly, this J, well, it is of course rooted at an ancestor in the tree of I, but also it has to come after I2 in the exploration of the tree. Okay. And if you like, this construction really explains the construction that I gave earlier, because what I'm doing here is just a discrete version of a tree plus a collection of pairs of points that I identify, where one of the points is an ancestor of the other. Okay, so if we go back maybe some steps away in the talk, this really corresponds to this construction of HS by identifying points with certain of the ancestors. Okay. So this is, you know, the discrete version for this construction. Now, as I was saying, we are interested in a different construction, which is the breadth-first construction. And to do this construction, it's really a matter of modifying just slightly the construction. So let me actually do it on the same example. So I start again from the same unicellular map. Not unicellular, I'm sorry, map with access 2 as before. Okay. And for the breakfast exploration, we do exactly the same. But instead of going from one corner to the next in the contour exploration, we explore all corners incident to newly visited vertex. Before moving on. Okay. So let's actually do it on this example. So again, I'm starting from the root vertex. So this is, or maybe the root corner row. And at this stage, my tree T, let me maybe call it T tilde, is just reduced to this vertex. And then what I do is, here I've explored all the corners incident to this vertex, so I move to the next available corner, which is this guy. But now, what I've done is that I encountered a new vertex, so I will finish exploring all the corners around this vertex before moving to the next available corner. So what do I do how do I do that in practice? I explore this first corner, and this corner is connected to an edge which does not create a new cycle in the tree. So I just add this edge in the tree, but I'm not going to explore this, let's say the first corner at the end of this edge, because I haven't finished dealing with that vertex. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm now going to explore this corner, which is connected again to a vertex that does not create an edge that does not create a cycle. And again, I pause and stop exploring this vertex before I'm finished with this guy. Okay. And then I explore the third corner incident to this vertex, and I realize that it brings me back to row, okay, which of course shows that I finished exploring this vertex. Okay. So now at step, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4, the tree T has this shape, and there are two corners that remain to be explored. Okay, and I'm going to explore them in the order of appearance. Okay, so at step 5, I'm going to start exploring this corner, and again, I will finish exploring completely this vertex before moving to any other. Okay, so let me do it concretely. So I first add this new edge, then add this one and add this one. And now I'm finished. And at step, 7 or so, the tree is going to look like this. But again, before moving to these three new uncovered vertices, I have to finish dealing with this guy. Okay, I'm really dealing with, a first in, first out queue here. So I have to finish dealing with this vertex. And now something interesting happens, because in the construction of the tree, I'm going to add this edge, but I'm not going to add that edge because it connects to a vertex that I've already explored. I mean, that I've already uncovered, even though I haven't fully explored it yet. Okay. So I cannot add this edge because it would create a cycle in the tree. So again, I'm going to somehow disconnect it, and remember that I have to connect these two corners together. Now I'm confused, sorry. These two corners together. Okay, so let's say maybe I and J. And then I continue the exploration. So I finished exploring this vertex. And now I have to move to this vertex, which is, you know, which has only one corner incident to that edge. Then I explore this vertex. And again, I have one loop here, which I have to ignore. And I have to remember that I had to connect these two I prime and J prime. And then I'm going to finish the exploration by exploring these two guys. Okay. And in the end, the result, so end up with, again, a tree that I want to call T tilde, plus pairs of corners. But now these pairs of corners are very different from the ones that I got from the depth-squared construction. Ah, okay, so that's actually very interesting because Christina is telling me that I have 5 minutes left and the clock on my iPad is for some very weird reason. Ah, so I mistook actually the clock of my iPad with the date of creation of this notebook, okay, which is on the top left of your screen and indicates that it's 40 past the hour. Okay, so that's quite interesting. Okay, so let me wrap it up in 5 minutes. That's very, very unexpected. Okay, so you end with a tree and a pair of corners, but now when you think about the tree, the exploration of the tree, in the breadth first construction, you have to explore it somehow layer by layer. And so the corners that are connected with each other are such that pairs of corners ik, jk, such that v of ik and v of jk lie at most one generation apart in T tilde. If you think about this construction, this I here is connected to J, which is just one generation after in the tree. Okay. And in the scaling limit, okay, so now let me finish by discussing the scaling limit. So in the scaling limit, it means that we are going to have to connect vertices in the tree, let's say pairs of vertices in the tree, which are at the same generation in the tree, where generation is just distance from the root. Okay. So how do we do that? Well, we need a way to select pairs of vertices that are at the same height. And here is how we do that. So in order to do that, I'm going to have to introduce one last notion. So we let L T y of E be the what is called the local time of the Brownian excursion at height y and time t. So this is actually, okay, this is a measure of the set, okay, of times s less than t, such that E of s is equal to y. In terms of the tree, it corresponds to a measure of the different generations of the tree at a certain stage in the contour process. And here is now what I'm going to do. So, okay, again, maybe I should draw a little excursion picture. So if I have a time t here and a height y on the y-axis, then L t of y is just measuring how many points, somehow, how much time you spend at this height before time t. Okay, okay, so now here is the construction. So define a new excursion e tilde of s by absolute continuity. And the definition is going to be the exact same as before, except that I'm going to twist the expectation, not by the area, but by the integral of the local time at time one of E squared and to the power S. And again, I'm going to divide this by a normalizing constant. So how should you interpret this quantity? Well, this quantity is just the mass, the total mass, if you like, of pairs of vertices in the tree that stand at the same height when I choose S of them. Okay, so it's a way to understand this, because again, this somehow counts the number of vertices standing at a given generation. Okay, so that's the first step. And the second step is, given E of S, we choose pairs of points, let's say Ti and Ti prime, for one less than I less than S, according to the measure, which is the integral from 0 to infinity of dy, so I'm integrating over all heights in the tree, times the derivative of the local time at height y, dt prime, the derivative of lt prime at height 1, e of s. So what I'm doing is I fix somehow a height y, and then I'm choosing two vertices at this height according to the measure given by the local time. And the final construction is that let h tilde of s be equal to the tree coded by t of e of s, quotiented by the equivalence relation that associates ti and ti prime together for every I between 1 and s. So I'm just going to glue these pairs of points together. Okay. And I'm completely out of time, but the main theorem now is that this space, H tilde of S, is equal in distribution to the H of S that was in the previous theorem. Okay. And what's more, the tree, this should be an E tilde all over the place here. And what's more, this tree, which I'm taking the quotient from, is really the breadth first tree of this space H of S, essentially because because of this construction somehow. You just identify points that are at same distance from the root. Okay. And from this construction, we are able to obtain certain properties of the distribution of the limit, but I don't have time to to talk about that. So sorry about the confusion, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Gregory. I'm just waiting to see if any questions are going to come up in the chat. Perhaps while we wait, maybe I can have one. So do you obtain an independent proof of the convergence result from your work?
Yeah, I think we do. Yeah. I think we do. I have to think carefully about it, because so what we actually proved is that this H tilde, yes, we proved that this H tilde is the scaling limit of the uniform model of maps that I described for you, and just by doing the two construction, we obtained that the scaling limit is also your H of S, but. Mm-hmm. But we have an independent proof of the fact that the limit exists. Yeah, we.
Great. Thank you very much. There don't seem to be any other questions out there. So what I'm going to do is, in a moment, I'm going to stop recording and I'm going to propose that we unmute everybody and have a round of applause. And then we'll take a 25-minute break. So the next talk will be from Olivier Bernardi and is going to be at 3:30 p.m. UK time. So let me just stop recording.